Funding for this program is made possible by a grant from the Rockefeller Foundation and by the financial support of viewers like you.
Amanda! Amanda!
Global Vision presents the television news magazine of Southern Africa.
It doesn't exist on television, and it doesn't exist.
I would actually appeal to the world that information is there and can be found.
Because it is important that people know what is happening.
A South Africa Now news special. Nelson Mandela, free at last. As the world watched, Nelson Mandela walked to freedom. We'll have a report on this historic moment. As South Africa celebrates, we'll look at what happened, how it happened, and what it all means.
We have waited too long for our freedom. We can no longer wait.
And as the world's media record the event, we'll look at how the government and self-imposed censorship shaped the story leading up to it.
You didn't see it on television, therefore it didn't exist.
All of these stories with some of the major players on the South African scene. Your host is television correspondent Charlene Hunter-Galt.
It was Nelson Mandela himself who once said, "There is no easy walk to freedom." He predicted better than even he knew. It's been a hard and long 27 years. But as millions watched, Nelson Mandela finally took that walk. On Sunday afternoon, he left Victor Verster Prison into the waiting arms of relatives and friends and the eyes of the world. For black South Africans, it was the end of what must have seemed an impossible dream. It was only in recent months that they dared hope they would see him in their lifetimes. In the streets of black townships, the long-awaited moment unleashed songs of joy and hope, the same kind of hope that is starting to emerge over the prospects of negotiations to end apartheid. What role is Mandela likely to play as the people of South Africa open a dramatic new chapter that could end with the creation of a democratic, non-racial society, or perhaps, in the state president's own warning words, and Armageddon. For the next hour, we will look at Nelson Mandela's walk to freedom and what it means for South Africa's future. After Sunday, February 11th, 1990, Nelson Mandela is free at last.
The system of apartheid imposed in 1948 divided the country's population into racial categories: black, white, colored, and Indian. The last census in 1985 counted 25 million black Africans, 4 million colored and Indians, and just 4.5 million whites. Since then, the black population has grown rapidly, but at least 87% of the land and almost all of the natural resources are still owned and controlled by the minority white population. Coming up next, how Nelson Mandela negotiated his own freedom.
The demand to release Mandela has for years been the rallying cry of anti-apartheid activists the world over. It has sparked countless demonstrations, UN resolutions, even rock concerts. But in the last year, one additional factor seems to have made the critical difference: Mandela himself. In early 1989, Mandela secretly launched his initiative in the form of a long letter to former President P.W. Botha, an implacable foe. It filled two whole newspaper pages. In it, Mandela laid out the ANC's views on crucial issues like armed struggle, communism, and the need for a negotiated settlement. Mandela offered to play a personal role in facilitating talks. He also made clear he was acting independently. He wrote, "I am acting on my own initiative in the hope that the ANC will in due course endorse my action." United Democratic Front leader Patrick Lokota, nicknamed Terror for his athletic prowess, spent years in prison with Mandela. He explains Mandela's role.
One ought to say that he didn't act just like an uninterested party in the situation. Certainly, he also acted as a window into the movement for the government. In talking to him, in listening to what he had to say, the government people were given a very deep insight into what our movement consists of, and into the direction it intends to take.
South Africa's ambassador to the United Nations, Jeremy Shearer.
Quite clearly, in the period of time that the ANC was banned and direct one-on-one discussions were difficult, yes, he was a window.
President Botha responded to Mandela's initiative, asking him to spell out his ideas on how to begin negotiations. Mandela then asked for a face-to-face meeting, and Botha agreed.
The state president and Mr. Mandela took the opportunity, however, to confirm their support for peaceful development in South Africa.
The unprecedented meeting took place in secret. According to news reports, Mandela pressed Botha to release his longtime ANC colleague Walter Sisulu and other political prisoners. But according to Lakota, this meeting had another important effect. It showed apartheid's defenders, he said, that a black revolutionary movement was willing to talk.
I think Nelson was able to crack the uncertainty which had up to that point in time paralyzed the National Party.
Meanwhile, Mandela smuggled a copy of his proposals to the ANC's headquarters in exile in Lusaka, Zambia. They reportedly endorsed his ideas for a negotiated solution, reassured that he still endorsed the armed struggle he himself launched and that was still being carried out by ANC guerrillas known as the Spear of the Nation.
Especially when we're talking about negotiations and working out the final details of that, I think it's very important that we also intensify the armed struggle, because it has been a protective cover for our people.
By late August, Mandela's plan was being endorsed by all the African states. It called on the South African government to take specific steps to create a new political climate, including ending the state of emergency, freeing all political prisoners, and unbanning the ANC and other groups. At this same time, inside South Africa, a massive new defiance campaign started, challenging apartheid laws and bans on political activity. The movement's message to the de Klerk government signaled a more militant mood.
I say power to the people!
From now on, it is illegal for one of our organizations to be illegal.
As local and international pressure mounted on the government to implement reforms, Pretoria responded to one of Mandela's most insistent demands. Walter Sisulu and other senior prisoners were suddenly released.
It is the first conference of the ANC.
Out of jail, Sisulu went to work, conferring with Mandela and acting as a messenger for Mandela's directives, traveling for the first time to Lusaka, Zambia, for an emotional reunion with comrades he had not seen for a quarter of a century.
We've got a gathering of leaders from both inside and outside the country, and this constitutes one of the most important watersheds in our history, and in a sense is a measure of the new situation.
Mandela, meanwhile, continued to press the government to act. He met de Klerk and other ministers in the white government. Newspaper columnists joked that a white government was being run by a black prisoner with a fax machine, a sentiment gleefully echoed in the black community.
It's a weird situation. Here is a man in prison, but he's in touch with his organization, which is a banned organization, from prison. He telephones his colleagues in Lusaka.
Mandela's wife, Winnie, told us about how her husband talked to her about his own release during one of her many prison visits.
He was not prepared to be released to a South Africa whose conditions, which in fact had the conditions he fought against 23 years ago, and that his own personal freedom was of no consequence, that it was a liberation of his people.
Mandela's lawyer, Dolar Omar, explained how Mandela was using what bargaining power he had.
In fact, what Mr. Mandela has said is this: I don't want to leave prison empty-handed. If when I leave prison, when you choose to release me, nothing further has happened, there have been no changes, then I will go to Lusaka. I will report to my organization, in his words, that 3 years of talks have been a waste of time. I will go back to South Africa, and I will continue the struggle where I have left off, and I will be back in prison within a month. The choice is yours.
On February 2nd, after months of indecision, the South African government bought into the Mandela peace plan, at least in part.
The prohibition of the African National Congress, the Pan-Africanist Congress, the South African Communist Party, and a number of subsidiary organizations is being rescinded.
Black leaders inside the country argued that he hadn't gone far enough and does not yet deserve a full round of applause.
Why should Hitler be a very good man? We are the people, it is the movement, which has carried the burden of pushing him there. He is doing what he is doing, not because he woke up suddenly with a golden heart towards us. It was precisely because of the tenacity of the struggle of the people.
The South African government was under considerable external pressure to pull something pretty dramatic out of the hat with the parliamentary speech. The British and the Americans weren't going to hold the line on further sanctions unless something fairly significant was announced.
And so it was.
I am now in a position to announce that Mr. Nelson Mandela will be released at the Victor Verster prison on Sunday, the 11th of February, at about 3 p.m.
In the 27 years since he was imprisoned, Nelson Mandela has attained stature of near mythic proportions, both inside South Africa and abroad. Yet few people know much about Mandela the man and his extraordinary life before and during his imprisonment.
He now is much slimmer, his hair is almost white, he's clean shaven, and he really doesn't look at all like the picture that we all imagine him to look like. And that has afforded him a good deal of freedom and enabled him to move around unrecognized.
Although long banned from dissemination inside South Africa, Mandela's image has been celebrated worldwide in television movies like HBO's Mandela.
I have cherished the ideal of a democratic and free society.
And in popular music. Nelson Cholisasha Mandela was born in 1918 in the dusty farm village of Kunu, in that part of South Africa called the Transkei.
This is his family plot. The cattle pen was located over there. Just beyond the garden, you can see the family graves. The tombstones are over there.
His sister Mabel still lives there.
I noticed that many people recognized he was a bright kid.
Mandela was born to a royal family of the Tembu tribe. At school, Mandela was taught like an English schoolboy. At home, he learned traditional ways. He used his Western education well, studying law and then forming a partnership in a Johannesburg firm with Oliver Tambo, his lifelong friend.
Everyone came to know about them. The black people were very enthusiastic. Zulu, Xhosa, Sotho, Tswana. All were proud to see a black man who was a lawyer.
Mandela and Tambo soon had more work than they could handle, defending blacks caught up in the apartheid system. Inevitably, Mandela became involved in politics, joining the African National Congress, or ANC.
The apartheid system came with such a forceful, violent impact that it threw virtually everybody into struggle. And we decided to resist it by non-violent means.
Mandela became a leader of the ANC.
We wanted the ordinary system of government. Government of the people, by the people, and for the people. We said, it is useless to discuss this amongst ourselves with these white men who are misleading us. We must now first go and consult with our leader, Nelson Mandela.
Soon, Mandela's political activities made him a marked man. In 1956, along with 155 others, he was arrested and accused of high treason, a charge that carried the death penalty. But even his jailers treated him with respect. Fellow prisoner Paul Joseph.
When we used to exercise in the prison yards, the warders would come around and talk to Nelson Mandela, but they would refer to him as Mr. Mandela, and he had this tremendous respect from them, that he wasn't just referred to as Nelson or a nigger, but Mr. Mandela.
At the end of the five-year trial, everyone was found not guilty, but the ANC was by then banned and Mandela went underground. Mary Benson met with Mandela in hiding.
He was disguised as a chauffeur with a peaked cap and a long white sort of overall coat. And he offered me a ride home. So he was the chauffeur in the front, and I was the madam in the back of the car. But it was the most terrible rackety old car, which is, I suppose, the most the ANC could afford at the time. And I was terrified that we were going to break down, and here Mandela, the most wanted man in the country, would be discovered. But he seemed completely unaware of this danger. And to have such courage and a rather light-hearted approach. I had this impression of a man so full of vitality and optimism.
Meanwhile, there had been Sharpeville, 1960. Police massacred 69 protesters. An emergency was declared. Mandela's movement banned. The ANC decided to fight violence with violence.
This was the climax. This was the biggest single massacre. The whole country was shocked. The whole period of non-violent struggle in which we had been engaged for some 50 years was coming to an end. So this was a tremendous change because until then, the policy had been one of deliberate, conscious non-violence. Now we had to be deliberately, consciously violent.
There are many people who feel that it is useless and futile for us to continue talking peace and non-violence against a government whose reply is only savage attacks on an unarmed and defenseless people.
This is the last interview with Mandela we have. When his pleas for peace fell on deaf ears, the ANC turned to sabotage. Mandela helped form a militant ANC wing called Spear of the Nation.
Where you'd actually plotted a revolution, a death sentence was almost inevitable.
And Joel Jaffe was Mandela's defense attorney. In 1964, along with other leaders of the group, Mandela was caught and charged with sabotage and revolution. Dennis Goldberg was a co-defendant.
Our defense wasn't that we hadn't done it. It really wasn't. Our defense was why we had undertaken this action, why Umkhonto we seized, where the Spear of the Nation was set up, why we'd added this component of the armed struggle.
During his trial, Mandela attacked the authority of the court and the legitimacy of the state in a now famous speech.
If he gave that speech, he was convicting himself. He had to be convicted. And as he went on, it went on for about 1.5 hours, as I recall, the tension in the court grew more and more, and there was a silence, and you could hear a pin drop right through it, which was unusual unique in a speech of that sort. And the famous ending to his speech was, "I've dedicated my life to achieving harmony in this country and to fight for the rights of all persons. It is a belief which I hope to see achieved." And then he looked the judge straight in the eye and he said, "But if needs be, it is a belief for which I am prepared to die." And then he sat down, and there was a tremendous silence in the court for about 30 seconds, not a word. And then it was as if all the spectators' gallery were crammed, as if they started breathing again.
It was a moving affair. I still remember I told him that whenever it would be, on his return from prison, I would slaughter a cow in his honor. I said to him, "Go to prison, but we expect you back. Go, but we want you back."
But the government did not let Mandela go back. He was sentenced to life in prison here on the notorious Robben Island. He was forced to break rocks in conditions designed to break him. Toivo Ja Toivo, another political prisoner, was with him.
Whenever we had problems, he was the one who we used to send to the authorities to negotiate.
Patrick Lakota was imprisoned also with Mandela on Robben Island 6 years.
The first thing that I discovered when I met Nelson was just how simple and down to earth he was. He was part of us, part of the prison's population. Those who stayed with him would find him very homely, in the true sense that an African father can be. Would not hesitate to sit with very young comrades and share a meal with them, actually out of the same plate.
That's his greatness. That's really his greatness. That there was no question about his position of leadership. And he didn't lose those warm human characteristics.
I used to play tennis with him, and he used to beat me, let me tell you the truth. And he also discouraged me in learning chess, because he was so patient, taking his time. Perhaps in the whole day he can only play one piece. And I am so impatient, I couldn't sit for the whole day just waiting for a man to move one piece. I abandoned learning how to play chess.
We had a debate about the issue of whether whites had a role in the struggle or not. And it was, among other things, Nelson, who led in an in-depth input, analyzing our struggle, and also analyzing the presence of white South Africans, and showing how it had come to pass that white South Africans were in fact entitled to be in South Africa, and why it was not only their right but also obligation to join the liberation struggle and fight against apartheid. And that transformed me.
Mandela spent 12 hard years on Robben Island before being moved to a prison on the mainland. In 1988, just after his 70th birthday and seriously ill with tuberculosis, he was moved again to a prison hospital. Until today, he was confined here at Victor Vester Prison near Paarl, where his wife Winnie could visit him just once a month. She once said the separation had been cruel.
The tendency is to forget the brutalizing and traumatizing effect this whole exercise has on the family.
Nelson Mandela could have been freed years ago had he agreed to renounce his movement's armed struggle. But in 1985, at a rally in Soweto, his daughter Zinzi read his response to the government offer.
"My father says, I am a member of the African National Congress. I have always been a member of the African National Congress, and I will remain a member of the African National Congress until the day I die. I cherish my own freedom dearly, but I care even more for your freedom. My father says, I cannot and will not give any undertaking at a time when I and you, the people, are not free. Your freedom and mine cannot be separated. I will return. Amanda!
Mandela! Mandela!
Mandela's free, but South Africa's poverty still imprisons millions. Next.
Nelson Mandela's release will clearly heighten expectations of the country's black majority, most of whom live in poverty. The first step in meeting those expectations will be political. But it is also clear that the transformation of South Africa will require more than just political changes. Regardless of who is in charge of the government, enormous challenges lie ahead. With the black population growing and the economy damaged, even Mandela would be hard-pressed to change the lives of millions of South Africans who are trapped in decades-long poverty and deprivation. Based on a Carnegie Corporation study, South Africa Now's correspondent Carolyn Craven has our report.
Meet Dr. Mompela Rompelli and the economist Francis Wilson. They've written the definitive study, Uprooting Poverty, the South African Challenge.
We have in South Africa a systematic process of impoverishing people, which does not start with apartheid. It's a historical fact, whereby the whole colonial process was premised on extracting the wealth of the people for the benefit of the settler class or for the ruling class.
South Africa is a rich and powerful country. Its gold and diamonds fueled the growth of the most affluent and advanced economy in Africa. The South African government frequently boasts that its blacks are better off than Africans elsewhere.
Huge percentage of South Africa's black population who have indeed lifted themselves out of the third world.
These homes in Soweto are offered as evidence of the upward mobility of a few. There are reportedly 17 black millionaires in South Africa.
If you look at a statistic which you can use for comparative purposes, which is the infant mortality rate, that you find if you compare between black and white in South Africa and between black and black in the rest of Africa, you find that black South Africans are the worst off. In other words, white South Africans have an infant mortality rate of 12 per 1,000. Black South Africans an infant mortality rate of between 96 and 106 per 1,000, which is 8 times greater. And that infant mortality rate is itself higher than for a number of other black African countries such as Botswana or Zimbabwe or Algeria.
But the Carnegie Inquiry documents the lives of the majority with statistics and stories culled from their struggle to survive.
Even though I was born and bred in poverty, I never quite understood its many dimensions, its many faces, and the serious implications of what it actually meant to be poor.
The study, Uprooting Poverty, looks at the reality behind the images, like these. People living in hovels. Women lugging heavy loads of timber for fuel on their heads. Exhausted faces and defeated people. These are the faces of poverty. But the study makes three principal points that highlight the larger scandal. First, more than half of the black population lives on the brink, below the minimum living level.
The minimum living level is one of those scientific lines set which indicates that if you have not enough money to buy the basic necessities of life, you're going to be desperately poor. And below that minimum living level, we find on average between 60 and 65% of black South Africans are living. If you look in particular areas such as the reserves or what are called the homelands, the Bantustans, that figure is about 81%. In other words, 4 out of every 5 households simply can't make it.
Second, that South Africa has the highest level of inequality of the 57 countries studied. The gap between rich whites and poor blacks is vast.
Facts and figures of the gap between the very rich and the very poor speak for themselves, in that you do have inequalities in this country, but not to the same extent. You do have racial discrimination in this country, but it's not legitimated in terms of the law does not say you shall discriminate.
This is our dining room where we have dinner parties and where we eat on Sundays. Down there is the family room where the piano is and where we watch television.
This film about the worlds of two children makes the point.
This is Julia. She's our maid and she has been staying with us for about 3 years. She stays here. She is married and has two children, but they stay in the homeland and she visits them during holidays.
My house is not big enough for my family. This is my bedroom. It's my bed. I sleep here and my cousin and my aunt also sleep here.
Poverty in South Africa has several faces. The worst is in the so-called homelands or labor reserves, like Kwakwa.
Between 1970 and 1985, the population of Kwakwa has risen from 23,000 to of the order of 500,000 people. Not because people have rushed to get there because there are jobs in Kwakwa, but because they've been squeezed off the surrounding farms by the process of mechanization and agriculture, and they've not been allowed to go into the cities. This means that Kwakwa now has a population density, a rural population density, of perhaps 100 people, 100 times greater than the surrounding Free State farms. And the people who've gone there, some of them have gone because they've been squeezed out of agriculture, some because they've been pushed through resettlement policies of this government. And so that, in a way, encapsulates the way in which apartheid has caused poverty in South Africa.
And women seem to be the hardest hit.
Among the people who are most vulnerable to poverty are black women. All those households that are female-headed are actually the vulnerable households in terms of poverty. They are the most vulnerable households to poverty. And therefore, one is not really talking about cosmetic issues of women versus men, but one is talking about survival issues, because gender then becomes one of those determinants of survival. And therefore, it isn't really a question of just latching on to the feminist movement in the West. It's a question of talking about the realities of power relations in South Africa, and therefore the realities about survival in South Africa.
Geographic isolation has created a new class, long-distance commuters.
Somebody there may have to get up at 2 in the morning in order to walk perhaps for 20 minutes to a bus stop, to catch a bus at 2:30 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and then to take that bus into Pretoria, which could take 4 or 5 hours, bus ride into Pretoria, and then change buses to catch either a bus or a train to work, where he will arrive at 7 or 8 in the morning, and then repeat that whole process in the evening when he knocks off work at 5 o'clock, or she knocks off work at 5 o'clock, and get back at perhaps 10 or 11 o'clock at night. And so we have these extraordinary photographs, which were taken in one of the part of the study for this inquiry, of people simply asleep on the bus at 3 o'clock in the morning or 9 o'clock at night, doing this five days a week. And that is the only way in which they can find the money to keep their families alive.
South Africa's children are the youngest victims of poverty. Dr. Rompelli has worked for years in rural health clinics. She says that poverty means stunted bodies and an inferior educational system which prepares kids for low-paid jobs. This South African class prepares girls for domestic service.
We make your water soapy, and then we can steep the curtains, because curtain is stronger when wet than when dry, so we can rub it in the hands. Now just show me how to rub this. Show us the rubbing.
Despite the grim realities, the authors project an optimistic sense of the possibilities.
We have it within ourselves in terms of the material resources, the human resources, to actually create a better society.
Finally, uprooting poverty poses challenges, arguing that ending apartheid is only one precondition for assuring social justice.
Poverty mustn't simply be understood. It's much more serious than that. It has to be removed. It's an evil. And the question is, how do we turn our whole society around? Southern Africa, South Africa, apartheid. How do we transform all of that so that we can eliminate the very processes that generate the poverty?
You're watching a South Africa Now special. Next, a look at media censorship.
The Nelson Mandela story has rocketed South Africa back onto the evening news. After years of downgrading coverage, all the major news organizations are competing furiously to get the first interview with Mandela and to capture the best camera position. Yet for the past 5 years, government censorship there has affected the flow of news, and that censorship is still with us. President de Klerk pointedly didn't lift restrictions on TV and visual coverage. All week, reporters there have been harassed. One network correspondent was clubbed, and a videotape shot for this program was seized by police. Mark Burns has our story.
From ABC News, this is a special edition of...
In the last week, the news from South Africa was plentiful. ABC's Nightline broadcast hour-long specials. Here's Ted Koppel, superimposed in front of a video screen.
Things are changing in South Africa, but on the ground, things are very much the same.
To show how fast events are changing, Nightline contrasted its last major coverage 5 years ago with what's happening today.
In the past 5 years, South Africa has started to move from confrontation to negotiation.
They come here by the hundreds of readers.
But unintentionally, this very journalistic comparison raises a touchy question. Where have the TV crews been in the last few years? And why has the coverage been so spotty and for long stretches absent from sight? Part of the problem rests with a calculated decision reached in Pretoria to limit TV coverage like this that was turning world opinion against apartheid. The police came to hate the press.
You people must get out now very quickly, okay? Because you people are the fucking cause of this now.
Yeah, all right.
So get out.
Okay.
The state president was no more favorably disposed.
It is also a known fact that foreign newsmen often have foreknowledge of the time and place of violent incidents. All responsible South Africans view this state of affairs as grossly and even criminally unfair.
As part of its state of emergency, the government cracked down on the opposition and the opposition press. Censorship became the order of the day, although the rules were deliberately vague, designed to keep reporters off balance. Some journalists were singled out for rougher treatment. Newspaper editor Zwelakhe Sisulu was arrested.
They were, you know, waving submachine guns in my face and my wife's face, and they demanded to know where Zwelakhe Sisulu was, and I identified myself, you know, and clearly these fellows didn't know me. I identified myself, at which point they then said that I must pack my bag. And whilst I was doing that, you know, they kept prodding me with these machine guns.
Some newspapers were closed and others put on warning. Journalists spoke of mounting pressures to censor themselves.
It means that every journalist in South Africa has an inbuilt censorship, call it a bleeper. There's sort of a bleeper that goes off in your head whenever you look at a story. You have to know, you have to be a legal expert, you have to know all about a wide range of laws. You have to know what constitutes security action. You have to know what is subversive. Subversive is anything that virtually from criticizing the regulations themselves to calling for a boycott, to calling for a stay away, a strike, an illegal strike. So you every story you do, you tend to censor yourself as you go along.
In many cases, we work with our lawyers more than our sources. In other words, you have to tell your lawyer everything you're going to publish. In many cases, you have to read your story to the lawyer, which is a very difficult task. And in many cases, the lawyer is the one who's going to edit the story.
American photographer David Turnley was ejected for what the government deemed biased photo material.
For the first 6 to 8 months, I was every day in a various corner of South Africa photographing either confrontations between protesting blacks and South African police or funerals for blacks who had been killed in these confrontations.
Television journalists were next. Michael Burke of the BBC was also ejected.
I think it boiled down to the daily paper in Cape Town running two-paragraph story on the front page saying BBC and ITN have shown pictures of violence in South Africa for the first time since emergency regulations were passed. And somebody senior, we think probably PW Porter, seeing that and just going, throw them out, in a fairly arbitrary decision.
Critics charge that a climate of intimidation slowly led the networks to start pulling their punches. Former CBS producer Richard Cohen criticized the networks, his own among them, for video appeasement.
The press was so obsessed with its perception of itself as an endangered species, they were so afraid that they were going to get kicked out of South Africa that they backed away from ever testing the limits of emergency rule. And it's really as if they forgot why they were there in the first place.
In places where there's this kind of repression, Eastern Bloc countries, communist countries, it's a badge of honor for American journalists to press the margins, to test the limits, to get the story out. Well, you don't have that kind of attitude, by and large. There are some notable exceptions in South Africa, and I think that that has a lot more to do with indifference than fear.
The Canadian government commissioned a study on the effects of the media ban.
The report found that following the press restrictions, the three major U.S. networks carried far fewer items about South Africa in their evening newscasts. According to the report, Pretoria has been largely successful in removing scenes of poverty, violence, and human rights violations from the television newscasts of the Western world.
As the story began to shrink from view, prominent figures in American life began to speak out. Former President Jimmy Carter and Jesse Jackson among them.
The press has been too dormant, too timid, I hesitate to use the word cowardly, in fighting back. There was almost a giving up of courage by the major news sources from South Africa as soon as the Botha government said, we don't want any more news coverage of what's going on. I think had the press collectively and individually said we will not abide by this censorship, I think that you could very well have lessened the amount of restraint on news coverage out of South Africa.
We do know that if in fact this were 4 million black Africans oppressing 21 million white Africans, that our national attitude government and media would be different.
Prominent South Africans became concerned as well with what they saw as network complicity.
Everybody begins from the premise, oh yes, censorship works, the government has been so successful. The government is only successful to the extent that other people allow them to be successful.
There is still a continuation of this practice of making a continued presence of correspondence within South Africa a priority goal rather than reporting the truth.
South Africa went away as a news story in this country. It literally went away. You didn't see it on television, therefore it didn't exist. You know, it works. When you don't let cameras in, when you don't let them show the pictures, it actually works, censorship.
The networks would not be drawn into a controversy about diminishing coverage. In 1988, when Congress sought to investigate the effects of the media ban on viewers here, well-known media people were advised not to testify.
People that we had approached from CBS and from elsewhere who had agreed to come and appear initially at the hearing, as well as three or four other individuals from both television and print media, ultimately backed out. And the reason seemed to be a very consistent reason, that is, fear of retaliation.
NBC, who independent analysts confirm followed the story more closely than CBS or ABC, did defend its coverage.
It is absolutely true that we have tried to be careful in terms of how far we push it, because we still feel that it is important for us to have the opportunity to report from South Africa. We may at some point have to take a step in terms of reporting this story that would result in our expulsion. That is a possibility.
The South African government was pleased with the effects of its media ban.
On the whole, I am, yes. I think there's been almost a sea change in the coverage we are receiving. And I think there are serious and good journalists writing today who are getting beneath the surface, beneath the foam, as it were, and writing some really rather remarkable pieces on what is happening in South Africa.
You remember how it was before the emergency in 85. Every single night, Western television was completely dominated by images of incredible state violence and the level of resistance that was being portrayed gave everybody a completely different idea of the kind of feel of South African society. The Western media has really caved into the censorship in what I think is a very, very scandalous manner. Means that the South African government have had their way. They've been extremely, extremely successful.
This is the background against which today's coverage must be viewed. On February 5th, most of the coverage was upbeat, with positive reports on de Klerk's speech and the response by celebrating blacks. But on the same day, our camera recorded a police response in Johannesburg. Watch carefully. Here are the folks in the street. There's a camera crew covering them. Now here comes the police. The crew has now turned its camera away. The only crew not harassed is this one. They work for the police. Less than a week later, journalists were roughly handled while covering a township protest. Our camera was directly challenged, and we were told to stop shooting.
We're busy with a police action.
Okay.
And filming is just going to worsen the situation. We don't want you to film, that's it. What? Any more problems, we're going to arrest you.
We'll have to stop, we'll have to leave them.
We have never imagined for one moment that the international press is really impressed by a future black government in this country. We have never thought that they would be supportive of our cause.
Journalists are not there to serve a cause, but whose cause is served when they're not there at all? Will the cameras covering Mandela's release today be gone tomorrow?
Given your highly competitive private enterprise television system, everything depends on the dramatic picture. And if you don't have that dramatic picture, you don't get on the newscast. And if you don't get on the newscast, you fall out of the attention of the great American public.
This is Mark Burns reporting for South Africa Now.
Charlene Hunter-Galt speaks with South Africa's UN ambassador. Next.
In what appears to be a new policy of openness, South African government officials are making themselves more available for interviews. Shortly before the announcement of Mandela's release, I spoke with Jeremy Shearer, South Africa's ambassador to the United Nations, to discuss the dramatic gamble his government is taking.
The question is the facilitation of dialogue. Mandela in prison has always inhibited dialogue and negotiations for the new constitutional future. What is important is that we find people who can carry on a valid negotiation. He may or may not be one. We will only know on his release.
When do you foresee negotiations getting underway?
My impression is that we are moving fast. There's going to be a lot of talking at this stage. There's going to be a lot of establishing positions. Both sides will have to, in Chief Buthelezi's word, get their acts together. There will be a meeting, as you know, of the ANC in Lusaka to decide a measured response, and we will then, I think, have a clearer picture. The amount of goodwill that we hope will have been generated by the state president's comments last Friday should speed the process up. But I would still think that 6 months to a year is a reasonable time to expect this.
I know that it's not customary to ask ambassadors for emotional reactions, but I will. What is your emotional reaction to what's going on in your country?
Yes, I have a great sense of excitement at what is happening. I have known that it must happen, and again, those of us who have been working within the government and with the government within the whole reform process are delighted that the position has been reached where we can move these steps so much more into the open and into the public view. Nevertheless, I am a diplomat of fairly long standing, and everything that happens is tempered with reserve. Diplomats talk of steps, they seldom talk of breakthroughs.
Well, Mr. Ambassador, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We are joined now by three South Africans of differing political stripes. We'll find out whether their opinions differ in just a moment. Ambassador Jeremy Shearer, who is the South African ambassador to the United Nations. Mark Swilling, who is a political analyst associated with South Africa's Witwatersrand University. And Tebogo Mofole, who is the African National Congress representative to the United Nations. And I believe that this is the first time that you and Ambassador Shearer have ever sat down together. Ambassador, we've just seen you on tape when I spoke with you a couple of days ago before the Mandela release. I want to ask each of you a question. There are going to be political analysis of all kinds over the next few weeks. So rather than political analysis, I would just like to ask each of you as South Africans, having seen Mandela released today, having heard the remarks of the state president, and then Mandela's speech Sunday afternoon, what is your reaction as a South African?
Well, my immediate reaction as a South African is excitement at the road forward. I have a certain amount of trepidation watching the speech today and listening to crowd reaction, hearing the speech of the state president the other day, and also hearing reaction. One sees that there is a long way to go yet, but the step has been taken and it is exciting, and it's particularly exciting to be part of that. I hope that we can all, including those of us on the platform, work together in that direction.
Do you remember your first thoughts as you saw Mandela walk out of prison?
Oh yes, I was very moved. It really doesn't matter what you feel. A man who has been in prison for 27 years, for whatever reason, a prison is a prison, and when he rejoins his world and his family and his people, I think it is a very moving moment. And if that is a step towards reconciliation throughout South Africa, then it's something that I welcome deeply.
Well, I must say that I was overwhelmed by what I perceived as a sense of history. I couldn't help but get the feeling that we are witnessing in South Africa today something that is in fact going to stand out in the history of South Africa as an important moment in the forward march to our liberation to democracy in South Africa. As the ambassador has said, I do feel that the number of steps have been taken in the right direction. However, I do also feel that there is a lot that needs to be done in order to ensure that that climate that we so require for the creation of negotiations, the climate that we need in order to get negotiations underway, there's still a lot that needs to be done.
When one sees what is going on in the streets of our cities, one cannot but have a tremendous sense that the future has arrived, that history is being made in a way that we never anticipated.
Is it also the fact, and very briefly, Ambassador, that you wish you were home today?
I think we would all have liked to be at home today and yeah. to be part of what is going on, yes.
I wish I was home yesterday.
Thank you all for being with us, Ambassador Shearer, Mark Swilling, and Tebogo Mofole. Even so, the last word on this day goes to the man of the hour, Nelson Mandela.
Amandla! I Afrika! Ibuye! I greet you all in the name of peace, democracy, and freedom for all. But as a humble servant of you, the people. communities have made it possible for me to be here today. I wish to quote my own words during my trial in 1964. They are as true today as they were then. I quote, I have fought against white domination. And I have fought against black domination. I have cherished the ideal of a democratic and free society in which all persons live together in harmony and with equal opportunities. It is an ideal which I hope to live for and to achieve. But if needs be, it is an ideal for which I am prepared to die.
Nelson Mandela, Free at Last. A special presentation of South Africa Now was produced by Global Vision on a non-profit basis in association with the Africa Fund, an educational organization assisting black South Africans. Funding for this program is made possible by a grant from the Rockefeller Foundation and by the financial support of viewers like you.
This is PBS.